بحر الزمان تألقا وأضاء للدنيا طريقا مشرقا وهدى من الرحمن يهدينا به للصالحات وللمكارم والتقى هذا كتاب الله أعذب منهل أنعم به من مورد لمن استقى قد صانه رب العباد بحفظه وحماه حتى لا يضيع ويخلقا طوبى لمن حفظ الكتاب بصدره فبدا وضيئا كالنجوم تألقا وتمثل القرآن في أخلاقه وفعاله فيه الفؤاد تعلقا وتلاه في جنح الدجى متدبرا والدمع من بين الجفون ترقرقا هذه صفات الحافظين كتابه حقا فكن بصفاتهم متخلقا.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، وأفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم على سيدنا وحبيبنا محمد رسول رب العالمين وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. اللهم اجعلنا منهم يا أرحم الراحمين. This is the Quranic talk number 10 by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's blessings. In the last talk, we spoke by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's help about the first bounty and the first scientific miracle in the Quran. And that is, the first bounty of course is the creation. And of course it is a bounty for those who are living according to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's teachings. Otherwise for them, it is not a bounty. For them it is a big problem, it is a disaster, it is a nightmare. And this is why they commit suicide and they leave this life. But for us, by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's blessings, it is a great blessing through which, through this life, we know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We got to know this religion. We got to know this great creator subhanahu wa ta'ala. The other thing we mentioned is the first scientific miracle in the Quran, which is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created a human being from a clot of blood. And we mentioned that this clot is leech-like. It is like the leech in its action and in its shape. It clings to the womb or to the wall of the womb, and it does not cling after the sperm and the egg. They meet together and they constitute this clot. If this clot does not cling to the wall of the womb, there will be no embryo, and there will be kind of abortion. So it is leech-like clot, subhanAllah. And of course the Arabs will never know this. There are so many other miracles in the Quran, but subhanAllah, this is the first one in the first five ayat that were revealed to our beloved sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, اِقْرَأْ وَرَبُّكَ الْأَكْرَمُ. Read, and your Lord is the most generous, the most bountiful. Don't worry. Even if you don't know the letters and you don't know how to read and write, your Lord is the most generous. اِقْرَأْ وَرَبُّكَ الْأَكْرَمُ الَّذِي عَلَّمَ بِالْقَلَمُ. It is He, subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is He who taught humans what they don't know. الَّذِي عَلَّمَ الْإِنسَانَ بِالْقَلَمُ الَّذِي عَلَّمَ بِالْقَلَمُ عَلَّمَ الْإِنسَانَ مَا لَمْ يَعْلَمُ. It is He who taught with the pen. He taught humans by the use of the pen, by reading and writing. And He taught Sayyidina Idris alayhi salam first how to write and to use the pen. Through this reading and writing, humans got to know knowledge. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling His beloved sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, اِقْرَأْ وَرَبُّكَ الْأَكْرَمُ. Your Lord is the most generous. He is the one who taught people
by the use of the pen, he can teach you. Allah can teach his Prophet ﷺ without any pen, without knowing any letters, without any writing. الَّذِي عَلَّمَ بِالْقَلَمِ عَلَّمَ الْإِنسَانَ مَا لَمْ يَعْلَمُ. Again, he said, اقرأ وربك الأكرم. وربك, this word again, it tells you about the intimacy, about the love, about the care. وربك, the most merciful, the most wise, the most caring. وربك, the one who's raising you up, who's nourishing you in each instant of your life. He's the one who's the most bountiful. الأكرم. الَّذِي عَلَّمَ بِالْقَلَمِ عَلَّمَ الْإِنسَانَ مَا لَمْ يَعْلَمُ. He taught humans what they did not know. He taught humans what they did not know. And as he taught them by the pen, he will teach you knowledge from him subhanahu wa ta'ala. As he taught him, وَعَلَّمَكَ مَا لَمْ تَكُنْ تَعْلَمُ وَكَانَ فَضْلُ اللَّهِ عَلَيْكَ عَظِيمًا. Allah is showing his Prophet ﷺ that he gave him a great favor. He's telling him, he taught you what you didn't know. And his grace over you has been so great. وَكَانَ فَضْلُ اللَّهِ عَلَيْكَ عَظِيمًا. Also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala taught us what we don't know. And also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's blessings over us have been so great. So all praise and thanks be to Allah over and over again. Despite this fact, dear brothers and sisters, despite the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala taught his Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he told him and he asked him to keep asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for more knowledge. وَقُلْ رَبِّ زِدْنِي عِلْمًا. Say, oh my Lord, increase me in knowledge. So no matter how much you know, the master of creation sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the best of creation sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Sayyidul Khalq wa Habibul Haq sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah told him, say, oh Allah, oh Lord, increase me in knowledge. And we also should say this, Allahumma zidna ilman ya arhamar rahimin. But what type of knowledge, dear brothers and sisters? Now we'll see some hadith. Our Prophet ﷺ taught us what type of knowledge to ask. Because not every type of knowledge is beneficial. Some types of knowledge will be a proof against you on the Day of Judgment. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us of those whose knowledge will be used against them. A proof against them, not for them. Just like the Quran, as the Prophet said sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Al-Quran hujjatun laka aw alayk. The Quran is either a proof for you or against you. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it a proof for us. So despite the fact Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala taught his Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam the best of knowledge, is there better knowledge than Allah's words? Than the knowledge that comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as we read in Surah Al-Kahf. When Sayyidina Musa alayhi salam, he thought he is the most knowledgeable, but Allah told him, no, there is someone who is more knowledgeable than you. So he said, I'm not gonna be comfortable until I go to this one who is more knowledgeable than me and I will learn from him. وَإِذْ قَالَ مُوسَى لِفَتَاهُ لَا أَبْرَحُ حَتَّى أَبْلُغَ مَجْمَعَ الْبَحْرَيْنِ أَوْ أَمْضِيَ حُقُبًا. Then when he saw him, Allah told us, فَوَجَدَا عَبْدًا مِنْ عِبَادِنَا. الْخَضِرُ عَلَيْهِ السَّلَامِ فَوَجَدَا عَبْدًا مِنْ عِبَادِنَا. One of our servants, آتَيْنَاهُ رَحْمَةً مِنْ عِنْدِنَا وَعَلَّمْنَاهُ مِنْ لَدُنَّا عِلْمًا. We have given him mercy from us and we have taught him knowledge from us. Then Sayyidina Musa alayhi salam, right away he told him, قال له موسى هل أتبعك على أن تعلمني مما علمت رشدا. Can I follow you so that you teach me from what you have been taught? And you know the rest of the story. Our beloved sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, by this knowledge, this divine knowledge, has become the greatest creature sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. As he told us about himself sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, not out of pride but to know his level sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, I am the master of people on the Day of Judgment. He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, with all his humbleness, with all his responsibilities, he was the greatest person in every aspect of life. As a husband, as a leader, as a grandfather, as a father, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And they say, وَالْفَضْلُ مَا شَهِدَتْ بِهِ الْأَعْدَاءُ. If your enemies or a non-Muslim scholar or scientist give a testimony about our beloved sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that is a good proof. We do not need this proof, of course. But that is a proof for those ones who are non-Muslims. See what your friends, what those who follow what you follow, see what they're saying about our beloved sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Michael Hart is an American Jewish astrophysicist. He was specialized in astronomy and chemistry and physics. In 1978, he wrote his famous book, The 100 Most Influential Figures or Persons in History. And he has PhD in astronomy, and he has many qualifications. Who did he put number one as the most influential person in history? And he's a Jewish scientist. He put Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he said in his book, he said, there is no man in history who was supremely successful in both, on both religious and secular levels, except Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He was the only one. And he put Sayyidina Umar al-Khattab radiallahu anhu as number, anyone has an idea? 51. You were close. He put Sayyidina Umar al-Khattab as 51. He put number two, Isaac Newton. Of course, we reject this order, absolutely, because for us prophets, he would say, Musa, I think number three or four. Of course, we reject such order because for us prophets are the best. You cannot compare any person to prophets. Anyway, there is, I think, a greater testimony or more powerful testimony by Lamartine, the French historian. What does he say? He said, if the greatness of purpose and the smallness of means and the outstanding results, if these things are the criteria of the human genius, then who could dare to compare, this is his word, who could dare to compare any great man in modern history to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? No one can compare. We reject comparing these great prophets to any person. There is no comparison. Despite this, our beloved sallallahu alaihi wasallam was the most humble, and he would ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for beneficial knowledge. And every day after Fajr Salah, this is maybe one of the dua that is new for many brothers, and maybe we forget to say, to make sure that I give you the reference, because I have almost four hadith inshallah today. Imam Ibn Majah radiallahu anhu, we have almost three hadith today by Imam Ibn Majah. The Prophet would say sallallahu alaihi wasallam after Fajr prayer, Allahumma inni as'aluka ilman nafi'a wa rizqan tayyiba wa amalan mutaqabbala. Oh Allah, I ask you for beneficial knowledge and good sustenance and provision, halal and lawful, وَعَمَلًا مُتَقَبَّلًا, and accepted deeds. آمين يا أرحم الراحمين. اللهم إنا نسألك علما نافعا ورزقا طيبا وعملا متقبلا. He said صلى الله عليه وسلم, as in the hadith narrated by Imam Ahmad, والله إني لأعلمكم بالله عز وجل وأخشاكم له. Now here comes so important point. He's saying, I am the most knowledgeable one about Allah, and I am the most fearful one of Allah. I'm the one who fears Allah most, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So look how he connected sallallahu alaihi wasallam knowledge with fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this fear, which is called khashya, is not any fear. No, we have khawf and we have khashya. Khashya is fear, but it is mixed with awe. It is mixed with exalting. Not only love, تعظيم الخوف مع التعظيم. Awe and respect and glorification. Fear with respect and glorification and love. You fear a lion, but you don't have khashya of a lion. But you have fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and you have khashya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is why in the other ayah, إِنَّمَا يَخْشَى اللَّهَ مِنْ عِبَادِهِ الْعُلَمَاءِ. Those who have khashya of Allah from His, from among His servants, are those who have knowledge. So the more knowledge you have, the more khashya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala you have. If this knowledge is not resulted in khashya, in taqwa, as they say in the Arabic poetry, لو كان بالعلم من دون تقى شرف لكان إبليس أشرف خلق الله كلهم. If knowledge without taqwa will give you an honor, then Iblis would have been the most honored because he had a lot of knowledge. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the beneficial knowledge. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make the knowledge we learn as a proof for us and not proof against us. Two or three amazing ahadith I will finish with inshaAllah to, from the blessings of this ayah about read, about that Allah taught us what we don't know, about knowledge, about seeking knowledge. Let us reflect on these three ahadith inshaAllah to finish with and to finish our commentary on this surah or in the first, the very first ayah that was revealed to our beloved sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then we will move inshaAllah to the next ayat that were revealed to the Prophet ﷺ to get an idea about that these divine messages, the beginning of the message or the messages to our beloved ﷺ. This hadith by Imam Abu Dawood. Imam Abu Dawood radiallahu anhu, in his Sunan, he narrates that Kathir bin Qais narrates that he was sitting, he's saying, this person is called Kathir bin Qais. He's saying, I was sitting in the masjid of Damascus with Abu Darda radiallahu anhu. Abu Darda, one of the great Sahaba of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he was, this person was sitting next with Abu Darda in the masjid of Damascus. And he said, a man came. And he said to Abu Darda radiallahu anhu, I came to you from the city of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. From where? From Al-Madinah, the illuminated city. Al-Madinah al-Munawwara, ala sakinihi afdalus salatu was salam. May peace and blessings be upon the one who is dwelling it and who dwelt it sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and who is buried there. I came from there to here. What for? For a hadith. A hadith that I heard you narrating about the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He travels all this distance. Of course, no planes, no cars. If he's lucky, he will have maybe horse or camel or for a hadith, one hadith. And this is the hadith he narrated to us. This is the hadith that reached us. It is worth traveling the whole world to listen to this hadith. He said, I came to you to hear a hadith. I did not come for any need. لم آتي لحاجة. I did not come for any need. This is what I came for a hadith. Then Sayyidina Abu Darda رضي الله عنه, he said, yes. He said, I heard, سمعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول. I heard the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم saying, SubhanAllah, when I was reviewing the hadith, I stopped at the word سمعت, I heard the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. How lucky they were. How lucky they were. They heard these words fresh from the mouth of the best of creation صلى الله عليه وسلم. And Alhamdulillah, Allah also has blessed us and we have received these words. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us of those who act upon these words and who understand the sunnah and the way of our beloved sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the wise way. He told him, yes, I heard the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saying, مَنْ سَلَكَ طَرِيقًا يَطْلُبُ فِيهِ عِلْمًا سَلَكَ اللَّهُ لَهُ بِهِ طَرِيقًا إِلَى الْجَنَّةِ. Whoever seeks or goes or walks in a way to seek knowledge, then Allah will make the way of paradise easy.
That was the first glad tidings for him. Then he said, وَإِنَّ الْمَلَائِكَةَ The angels, they humble and they put their wings in being pleased with the seeker of knowledge. And the scholar or the knowledgeable person, everything ask Allah to forgive him. Everything ask Allah to forgive the scholar or the knowledgeable one or the seeker of knowledge, including the whales in the sea. The fish in the sea ask Allah to forgive the seeker of knowledge and the knowledgeable one, because they all benefit from his knowledge. Because his knowledge benefits all the creatures. This is the true knowledge. Then he said, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and the preference of the alim over the abid, the preference of the knowledgeable one over the ignorant one, is just like the preference of the moon when it is full in comparison or over the rest of the planets. How is the moon compared? The other planets, you cannot even see them. But the moon, especially when it is full, it is so illuminating. This is the difference, or this is the comparison between the knowledgeable one and the ignorant one. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us of the knowledgeable ones. Then he said, فَإِنَّ الْعُلَمَاءَ وَرَثَةُ الْأَنْبِيَاءَ Surely the scholars are the inheritors of the prophets. This is what we lack. We lack the true scholar who is a true inheritor of the Prophet ﷺ. In everything, not only in words, knowledge is not only words, in his effect, in his influence, not only by his words. As the scholars said, مَنْ لَمْ يَنْفَعُكَ حَالُهُ لَا يَنْفَعُكَ قَالُهُ The one who does not benefit you by his character, by his status, or by his situation, his words will not benefit you. And the last two hadith, the other one by Imam Ibn Majah as well, he said, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, whoever comes to my masjid, he did not come except for good, that he will teach or he will learn. Some of us, sometimes we attend a lecture or we listen to a file or we watch a video just because we want to find mistakes for this person. Or we attend a lecture just we want to see the mistakes he's going to do. We want to see what are the things he's going to disagree with us. So that we know what does this person belong to, who does belong to, which group, which... This is unfortunately how some Muslims do. No, the Prophet is telling you, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, whoever comes to the masjid, to masjidi, he's saying about his masjid, but as we will see in the following hadith, it includes every masjid, alhamdulillah. If you go to the masjid seeking good, that you will teach or you will learn, then you are as if you are a mujahid fi sabilillah. As if you are struggling and striving for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But if you come for other than this, then you are just like someone who's looking at the properties of someone else. What will looking at the properties of others benefit you? It's not yours. You will not get anything. See the example by our beloved sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the last hadith by Imam al-Tirmidhi radiallahu anhu. The Prophet said sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, مَنْ خَرَجَ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ مَنْ خَرَجَ فِي طَلَبِ الْعِلْمِ فَهُوَ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ حَتَّى يَرْجِعُ Whoever goes out seeking knowledge, then he is going for the sake of Allah. He is considered as mujahid fi sabilillah until he comes back. So if you die, you die as a shaheed. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us of those who seek knowledge for the sake of Allah. Our beloved said sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I don't know why I missed this hadith. He said sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, ask Allah knowledge that is beneficial. Salullaha. عِلْمًا يَنْفَى The meaning of the hadith, ask Allah for the beneficial knowledge and seek refuge with Allah from unbeneficial knowledge, the knowledge that does not benefit. And in another hadith, he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, very amazing hadith, I wish you all, inshallah, remember it. And I know you're not going to remember all the hadith, but inshallah, with the blessings of Allah and the new technology, you can watch the video and you can get each and every hadith, inshallah. He said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, one of his dua, Allahumma inni a'udhu bika, I seek refuge with you, min ilmin la yanfa, wa qalbin لا يخشى ودعوة لا يستجاب لها. I seek refuge with you from knowledge that is unbeneficial or non-beneficial, and from a heart that does not have fear and respect and does not have humbleness before you, and from dua that will not be responded to. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept from us. Jazakumullah khairan. Sallallahu ala sayyidina Muhammad.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، الرحمن الرحيم، مالك يوم الدين، إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين، اهدنا الصراط المستقيم، صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. وإذ قال موسى لفتاه لا
اتخذ سبيله في البحر عجبا قال ذلك ما كنا نبغي فارتدا على آثارهما قصصا فوجدا عبدا من عبادنا آتيناه رحمة من عندنا وعلمناه من لدنا علما قال له موسى هل أتبعك على أن تعلمن قال له موسى هل أتبعك على أن تعلمن مما علمت رشدا قال إنك لن تستطيع معي صبرا وكيف تصبر على ما لم تحط به خبرا قال ستجدني إن شاء الله صابرا قال ستجدني إن شاء
قال فإن اتبعت
يا حافظ القرآن رتل آيه فالكل أنصت للتلاوة مطرقا يا حافظ القرآن لست بحافظ حتى تكون لما حفظت مطبقا ماذا يفيدك أن تسمى حافظا وكتاب ربك في الفؤاد تمزقا
فتمسكي بعراه كي لا نغرقا ولتجمع حول الكتاب شتاتنا حتى نزيل تناحرا وتفرقا ولتجعلي محكما في أمرنا وثقي بوعد الله أن يتحققا يا أمتي القرآن حبل نجاتنا فتمسكي بعراه كي لا نغرقا.